So I'll just tell our story about how we introduced Kong into Ola and we leveraged it to bring a central point of security and resilience into Ola. So who am I? I'll start with that. First of all, I'm a principal engineer who's handling all the security efforts of Ola. I'm the one who brought Kong into OlaCabs. So if you have ever seen the security tools which is open sourced by Ola, that's the architect of that is myself. And that's just about myself. I'll just go and start with my presentation. So why we started using Kong? So long story short, we had used another API gateways, but you know that turns out to be we have to put another gateway in front of gateway to save the gateway. So that's where we started looking alternatives. I'll tell you that story about. So first of all, what are we doing with Kong and why we started using Kong? So to enable security in single place or having a lot of legacy service, it's very difficult to introduce security. And bringing it that into a single place, it's extremely difficult. So that's where we started looking at Kong. And as a single point where all the ingress traffic comes through Kong, and we plug in our all infrastructure for authentication and security monitoring at Kong. So, and by that, we wanted to confine all our authentication, monitoring, you know, what else? Whatever it is possible to secure our customers' traffic that we plugged into Kong. So this enabled us one more thing called, so the major pain point which we have seen in Ola was like there are a lot of legacy services and a lot of people, you know, it's good to have logging everywhere, but when it comes to security, that's the worst thing to log customers' access tokens, refresh token. So the reason being is this. So users are not aware of the criticality of that particular piece of data which they are logging in, right? So we wanted to abstract the authentication and authorization for customers and rather not give them access to the customer's critical piece of data. That's what we do by abstracting authentication from developers. So all they need is like whom they are operating with, what access level they have, whether they are already authorized. That's what they want. They don't need to look at their access tokens. They don't want to look at the refresh tokens or all such things for, you know, using serving a customer's request. So that's what we did by abstracting all the authentication and authorization to Kong, and Kong handles all these authorizations and authentication for us. So with all these things in single place, right, we got a single place where we can actually put levers and, you know, controls to control the, I mean, rate limit the services, short circuit the APIs when we are in chaos. And that's what given us the entire control if there is something going chaotic. And with this particular monitoring, what we have achieved is a single monitoring, single place where we can look when something goes wrong, and it will tell us how things went bad, which went bad, and how it went bad, right? So I'll give you a graph which I started saying, right? We were using a Java API gateway, and I'll explain by graph. If you look at the first graph, it shows the latency when there was a hardware spike at our service. So to give you a glimpse of what scale we operate at, we handle almost like several millions of bookings per day, which roughly translates to several million transactions per minute. So at this scale, even a single hardware spike which lasted for like say 2 minutes brought our a lot of booking loss to us. So this is the story where, you know, there was a hardware spike and we were using a Java gateway. The first thing, first graph if you see is the service which went latent. Due to the database spike, the service went latent and, you know, the service started giving up the request and so it wasn't able to serve anything. So we throttled it, the service came back again, but the organic traffic, which the people were trying to book again, you know, all such things started bombarding us again. So if you look at the second graph, it's the throughput which we started getting. So if you look at it, it's a spike and a drop. So the first drop, then the spike, tells us that we recovered. But at that point, if you look at the gateway latency, the gateway also given up. So it's the reason being, we analyzed it, and we figured out the gateway was using a thread per request. So ultimately, this all three graphs is exactly same. So if you look at it, the gateway latency is always the latency of the service plus the latency incurred by the gateway to operate. And the last graph tells us that gateway was never able to recover, that the AppDex score of the gateway. So the moment onwards, the issue started. So always the service was recovering, the gateway was becoming latent, but gateway was never able to serve because the containers was dying. And that's where, to get this situation sorted out, we wanted to put an Nginx in front of it. We throttled a gateway traffic using Nginx. And that's the day when we understood that this Java gateway thing is not going to work for us. And that's where we started looking at Kong, because the first thing which we wanted to look, it's built on the very stable base of Nginx. So we started looking at Kong, and you know, it's very, very fantastic because it's having an API, admin API, which can control all the APIs in dynamic fashion. That's one of the reasons which helped us choose Kong over the other gateways. Okay, so this is roughly the most minimalistic architecture how we use Kong, and there are load balancers and all those things in between. But all the mobile traffic, all the supply side traffic, when a driver comes in online, from drivers goes out online, goes offline, all the traffic gets into Kong. And all our authentication stacks and auditing systems are are connected to Kong. And so so there is something called as Ola Command Center, which is a bunch of people who are setting and monitoring all the Ola's traffic. And if there is any anomaly, what to do next is the immediate first level of action is always done by this Ola Command Center. So they also, you know, work with Kong. They don't understand the downstream, so the people comes and goes often. So they don't actually have a holistic view of Ola. So how do they control without knowing the entire Ola? How do they control? So to say holistic view of Ola, it's around 900 plus services. They cannot understand every service. They cannot actually go and manage every service by themselves. So they are like limited number of people. So that's where we put in Kong in front. And so the Ola Command Center operate on Kong. So and all the access and authentication happens on Kong. So if any request pass Kong, that's trusted by all our downstreams. So that's what we use Kong for, and how we use this authentication to extend to our legacy services. That's the story, the first story which I wanted to tell. So Ola was built almost 7 years ago, and at that point we wanted to we want to increase the number of customers, number of drivers, and all those things. And you know, authentication was not our top priorities. And coming down the lines, we understood that the number of increased security problems and frauds which are happening in Ola, we understood, okay, authentication should not take the second seat. Now, how do we actually enable authentication for all this, say, 300 plus services which are in supply out of the 900 service, which is a mammoth task if you want to edit every service, right? So we had already a supply authentication stack which do authentication for all the new services, but all the old services are still legacy. They have no clue about how to authenticate. All the APIs works on headers. They don't have any idea. If you give an access token, they just give up. They don't even understand how it works. So that's where we built a custom authentication plugin into Ola, into Kong. So that's what Ola's, it talks to authentication stack. But the problem comes in this way, right? All these downstreams are designed for that particular time, and all this particular downstreams takes headers in a different format. And you know, the one downstream accepts one particular set of headers, the other downstream accepts a different set of headers. One accepts in query params, one accepts in body. So this becomes a mammoth effort. If you literally want to put that into authentication stack, not happening. So that's where we wanted to figure out a place where we can actually bridge all this gap. So that's where we put a Kong in front, and we used the capacity of Kong to transform the request to authenticate all the downstream, right? So what happens is the app sends us an access token. We have a custom plugin called as the API authentication plugin, which is custom built in-house on Ola, which support authentication configs. So this is how a typical configuration of authentication plugin looks like. Whenever you onboard an API for authentication, you can actually choose which version with which you can authenticate it. And it's completely configurable. So if there is a downstream which we want to authenticate today, we just wanted to add a piece of JSON into that particular authentication plugin. So that next time when the request comes in, the authentication plugin is smart enough to understand how actually to read the request and you know how to authenticate it. So when what this tells is like the auth config auth version tells that, OK, this is how, where you should read the tokens, and this is how you should transform the tokens. I'll touch upon how the config looks like in the next stage. But what if you have an app which don't send an app or token? You don't want it to send to the authentication stack because that's, you know, it'll go into a cat and mouse game, and you know it keep looping, saying that the access token is not sent to the Kong, and Kong sends it to authentication stack. Authentication stack rejects it. The app again retries it. Instead of that, it's a bad request. So you don't want to send it literally into authentication stack. So you can actually tell the authentication plugin what response code you want to send it back if there is no access token present. So there's a story behind this particular thing, because we have actually seen an outage because people made an API. So with this level for authentication simplicity, right, people just enabled an API, made it authenticated, but app doesn't send an access token. So literally, we went into a loop where, you know, we keep trying to authenticate, app don't send an access token, we created an outage, and that's where we started putting in, so if there is a config miss, what should we actually send it? And OK, what happens if there is a 403, right? Do you want me to redirect them to login page? That's been configured at this particular page itself. So all these things done, you authenticated, you're fantastic, you got an user, but user doesn't have permission. So even that can be delegated to the downstreams, right? The reason being, downstreams still don't understand authorization, but you want to make it authorized. So that's where, you know, in the plugin itself, you can actually tell that, OK, these are the roles for this user which are allowed. And our authentication stacks are clever enough to upgrade the role via the backend if you want to. So whenever Kong comes in picture, the next authentication comes in, user have an upgraded role. So that's been used even for our on-duty, off-duty use cases. So this is a simple config which you can actually look at. This is how our authentication configs have been added. So if you look at it, which authentication stack you want to contact towards, how much time you take to authenticate. So I have actually put cut down the access token headers and all those things for security purpose. But you know, if you look at it, it's the same configuration. So whether a header is being it's read from headers, and if it's whitelisted, it'll pass through the downstreams. And when the response is being sent from the authentication stack, how do you transform it to a response which the downstream understands? So whether you want to put it into headers, query params, body, inject it into body, your response JSON will help you do that. So this is how we done authentication, extended our existing authentication to all our legacy services. So now all our legacy services are authenticated. And when I said authenticated, it's around 850 APIs in one shot. So we were able to authenticate all our 850 APIs without even touching any of our 40 downstreams. So that's how we enabled Kong to leverage authentication to all our legacy services. So I'll move on to how we built resilience and security monitoring into the same system. So if you look at it, this is one of the internal control panel, which actually controls all our Kongs. So if you look at this particular dashboard, you can actually see all the APIs listed, and you have a particular value you can set against the API. So that's where I said, first of all, our choice of Kong was the extensive admin API, which Kong supports us, Kong provides us. So we leveraged all those APIs, and we have a dedicated setup, 24/7 monitoring all of our existing systems. And if they figure out something wrong, the first level of defense is always on that team. And that team have no clue about all the downstreams. But they only know that, OK, so this particular bunch of APIs, if we touch, nothing is going to be wrong about the entire infrastructure. So how do we actually put that in? So we read this particular data from Kong, where we have marked these plugins, or these particular APIs are, you know, safe to throttle. And there are critical APIs which never comes into this dashboard. So if there is any issue comes in, and if you see the stack is going chaotic, and it's not actually able to scale up, the first thing when they get an alert, they comes to this particular dashboard, looks at which all APIs are actually having high throughput. They cut down the throttle, they cut down the APIs request rate so that we have enough breathe time within the time when the developers or the DevOps check in. So this when the what we have seen is that golden hour, or the 10 minutes of first when the issue starts happening, right, if we have got breathe space, we can actually save a lot of outages. That's from my experience. Initial days, we were not able to, when we were using other gateways, which was not possible because we wanted to go into the system, look at the config files, edit it, reload it. I mean, it's like that entire process, it will take 10 to 15 minutes versus the Kong's admin API made us do it in like, say, a minute, or rather less than a minute. So this resilience platform given us, you know, capability to control all our infrastructure without even touching the actual Kong, because they don't. So the ultimate point is like the command center doesn't know they are talking to Kong. They don't know which Kong they are talking to. They only know that, okay, at this supply, this particular time, supply is high, and we are not able to cope up with our traffic. So how do we actually cut down? That's the only thing which we want to know. So how do we actually, this is how we cut down things. How do we actually figure out there is something wrong? That's where our monitoring comes in picture. So we use Kong StatsDB plugins, and we push all the metrics into our Grafana dashboards. And if you look at it, we have an extensive dashboard with which we can actually filter per API level. So it might not be looking that interesting when you say that, OK, you have all APIs, everything. But think of this situation where you have 40 plus downstreams and 850 odd APIs. Which API went bad? You have to run through 40 systems API metrics. Or rather, you can come to Kong and say that, OK, which API started misbehaving? And every API starts with a context path or the team name. So if you know the team name, it's pretty easy. You don't, rather than cycling through the 40 API metric, service metrics, you can just come back here and look at the metrics, figure out which is the service, go to that single API metrics, and you know, you can actually look what went wrong with the service. That's about how you monitor the normal production traffic. Similar to the Ola command center, we have something called a security operation center. So if there is a security activities which is happening to our infrastructure, how do we actually monitor that? So that's, again, all the traffic comes and goes out of Kong. That's where our auditing, the Kong's normal response size plugins and response size metrics and everything helps us. How understand that there was something going wrong? So if you look at the second graph, it's about the response which we went out every time. So every single time we used to send, say, 1 MB per minute, and all of a sudden we started seeing 3 MB per minute. So this triggers an alert not to command center. This triggers an alert to the security operation center, something went wrong. We started sending data out. It can be a possible SQLI, which is SQL, the well-known SQL injection where people started digging data out of Ola, or anything which is completely new. So that's where the fun fact starts, right? So you figured out that there is something wrong. How do we actually understand what is going wrong, right? So similar to the Ola command center, the dashboard which I shown you, there is something which is called a security operation center dashboard, which I cannot show you because of it's very much proprietary to Ola. So what it does is you can select an API. You can say that, OK, these are the parameters to match for that API. Route the traffic to our honeypot. So boom, all the traffic which goes to the downstream is now traffic diverted to our honeypot. And we can actually monitor what is there in that traffic. We can understand what is the attack pattern which is happening to that particular traffic. With this attack pattern, we can actually understand what the attacker is trying to do with our systems, right? Literally, the attacker gets the response which they think that it's valid, but they get an traffic which we mocked out of our downstreams. So that is what we do with Kong in a central place as for security. So this given us a flexibility to look all our services as one, though it's for microservices, it's completely a distributed system. But the problem here is, with all the distributed system, observability becomes a very, very, very difficult problem. And that's how we solved it. So when the honeypot gets the traffic right, so we have actually figured out, blocked our attacks in much, much faster than we when we were exposing all our microservices using an Nginx outside. So that's an advantage which Kong brought us. And lastly, I'll explain about a bunch of custom plugins which I have actually built in. So if you look at it, we just don't serve Kong as a backend, API backend. We use it for API, web frontend also. So I mean, that's not something which Kong is built on, but our custom use cases, which made sure that when you hit anything, suvidha.olacabs.com, workshop.olacabs.com, all these things hits the same Kong. But how do we actually differentiate? So Kong out of the box supports host-based routing, API-based routing. But we were in a situation we wanted host-based routing first, transfer it to API-based routing and apply a different set of plugins. How do we do that is always a question for us. So what we have built something called as the base path rewrite plugin. Whenever a traffic hits us, what we do is we first check the host. We apply a set of regex matchings into that particular incoming request. And we rewrite the entire request into a different particular API. And on that particular API, we apply all the plugins. So which essentially means that though it doesn't looks like you are hitting different Kong, but essentially you are hitting all your traffic of supply hits single Kong or single cluster of Kong. So this enabled us to serve all the APIs, all the web front ends without COS enabled. No systems of our supply is COS enabled. So it's not a single place where we wanted to look for whitelisted domains and all those things. All our APIs are serving from the same, for the customer, it's always the same front, same API they are hitting from the same domain. But literally, it's hitting multiple services, multiple domains internally. And this is how we done that. So, and I talked about our scale, right? It's about 1.7 to 1.8 million requests per minute. And at this point, even a single line of log statement takes enough of a load into our systems. So that's where we wanted to build in the HTTP logging plugins. So where if something goes wrong, how we told about traffic, diverting the traffic into honeypot and all those things. But you literally can't look at all the logs at the same real time, right? How do we transfer all the logs? Figured out from all your metrics, you figured out you're under attack, you have a lot of problems. How do you route the traffic into our data warehouses where you can do the slicing and dicing? That's where we have written something called as an HTTP logging plugin. So what it does is whenever a request hits Kong, it spins up another Nginx sub-process, takes the entire HTTP payload, takes the correlation ID as a transaction ID, push that into Kafka. So we have our own data warehouses which can take the data from Kafka and put that into our S3, and on top of that, we have Hives. And the same thing happens when the response comes back. All our downstreams sends back the transaction ID. This transaction ID becomes the correlation ID for our responses. So every request, we know what went out of ours, right? So we do analysis on top of that, or rather our security operation teams do analysis on top of this data. So literally, if there is we figured out there is an attack happened, we can actually go back in time and see whether this similar kind of attack happened even in a small scale. So that's what where we can actually understand when the person who actually tried and figured out when they can start manipulating the services. So this is the power of the HTTP logging plugins which we have done. And you've seen the command and control service center, right? So how do we actually do all this shutting down the APIs and restricting the APIs to a particular limit? So essentially, when a person in the Ola command center clicks on a button saying that, okay, shut down this API, it's just adding a short circuit plug into that particular API. It doesn't add any configuration. It's just directly adding a short circuit plug into that API. We do patch calls to Kong to add a short circuiting plugin, so that the traffic is nullified there. So even if there is a bombarding of our DDoS happening to any of the services, we just can click one by one click, we can actually minimize the traffic. All our downstreams are secured, and Kong takes the safeguard of that particular infrastructure. So when we moved out to, we bought a new company called as Food Panda, an Indian operation. So that's what we wanted. We got a particular the tech which they have actually handed over, and we wanted to integrate that to Ola's tech. So that's where Kong right now supports selective routing already, but we have written it in our internal style because we wanted much more attribute based and host based controls. It's just not host based. It's based on headers, query params, n number of stuffs. It actually creates an attribute set, and based on that attribute set, it routes the traffic to a particular domain. And if you look at the API redirection plugin, it's very, very similar as the BasePath rewrite plugin. But what it does is, if you just web front end, you might have seen that people wanted to redirect to a different home page, always when there's something going wrong. But I mean, this is something which every web guide write. So write a simple script to redirect, JavaScript to redirect back to home page. So that's where we thought everything is hitting Kong. Why don't we give that flexibility directly to Kong? So you just tell that, OK, when you hit this particular endpoint, if this attributes doesn't match, just redirect back to this particular endpoint. That's it. So that's a configuration which they can actually push into Kong. And Kong takes care about redirects. They don't worry about anymore putting into their code. They change it whenever there's a particular header. They don't want all these if-else conditions in their code. And with all these things, we have another plugin which is called as custom IP blacklisting plugin. So everyone read IP from left to right. We read it from right to left. So that's what we have figured out. So we know our stack better. So we know, if somebody is actually injecting your headers and IPs into your X forwarded four, you keep appending it. But we know the first public IP always starts from the left. So how do we actually tackle that problem? So we have a lot of rate limits and all those things in this IPs. So that's where we started reading IP from left to right, so that we figure out the first public IP on the right side, and we rate limit on that. So that even if people inject 100 IPs behind that, we still rate limit you on the first public IP. So that's our story about Kong. So I think, considering our old gateway from Kong, we have changed a lot. Our security operations monitoring, the production monitoring, the simplicity of developers to onboard APIs, all those things became so easy. And that's what a well-thought system can change. Thank you. Sure. Yeah.
Are those plugins open source?
So there are a lot of things, plugins which are custom made for Ola. That's not open source. The rest of the things we are cleaning it up for making it open source. We haven't open sourced any of that. So we are cleaning all the plugins so that we are removing all the proprietary code out of that, and then we are open sourcing it. So for instance, the authentication plugin actually can talk to all the authentication stacks. So. Yeah, so we are in plans for open sourcing it, but we wanted to strip down all the proprietary code out of it. So, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.